Good morning, and let me just thank the organizers for giving me an opportunity not only to make a presentation of the work I do on women in science. Like the last 2 days, you all have been sharing the work that each one of you all are doing in science. For me, each one of you are data points in terms of understanding my research. And so for me, getting into fora like this becomes extremely important because I really see the diversity of women scientists, and the more groups I meet, the more I'm convinced that I have less understood this group because it is extremely diverse. So let me just walk you all through some of the main points that I thought is useful. I would just have 3 parts to my presentation. The research that I do is over a decade old, and one of the reports that Dr. Rohini circulated was a study that we did, which was a marker in terms of the study that we did on women in science, which was the first study in the country that had the natural scientists and the social scientists coming together, conceiving the problem, looking at the kind of data that we need to sort of generate, and then looking at the analysis. So right through the entire study, it was done with the scientists and the social scientists. The important point that I want to mark is when we did this particular study, NIAS being a neutral body and being trained in social sciences, the confidentiality of the data was extremely important in conducting a study of this kind. And we were able to secure that to say that the data would be with NIAS and no identity of the scientists would be revealed, but we will use the data in an aggregated form so that we are able to look at policy interventions. And I think this was a huge difference in terms of the kind of study that we did. The data that we generated was very large, over 681 women scientists from across the country. We also interacted with men scientists, which was about 161, because it's very important to understand how men navigate the workspaces that women are trying to enter, not to imitate, but very importantly, to have your strategies of navigating that particular space. So we also had men scientists, and the study for me was a clear eye-opener because I started off with the hypothesis that the women scientists are not a homogeneous group. They are extremely diverse, and unless that is recognized and you get perspectives from the different subgroups of the women scientists, you will not be able to impact policy. So more on the study I would share, maybe informally if people are interested. Let me go on to my presentation. The guiding questions of the research that I've been doing over the last decade is, how do you evaluate women's professional success when compared to men's? And here I think one needs to look at numbers, the educational level, the gender, the stereotypes. Broadly, these are the categories that one needs to examine. It is also important to see that your research is guided by what I call as professional outcomes vis-a-vis familial outcomes. Although many of us do understand that science is a very demanding career, a large number of women straddle their professional lives with familial lives. So how do you understand this particular process through which women straddle this, because it is also extremely dynamic and very diverse? So what sort of worked with a set of women with a certain community or a country during the 60s or the 70s is not what today women are actually doing. And so I think it's important to capture that difference. It is also important to look at the pipeline metaphor and trace the journey of the scientists as an undergraduate to the level of professorship and maybe leadership further on. Because it is important to see through this pipeline where are women leaking out, particularly for different countries, because the story in India is extremely different from the story in the West. Because the issue we have is not the leaky pipeline very early in the higher education trajectory, but the leaky pipeline for this is after the women finish their doctorate degrees. And that is a huge loss for a country as large as India, which is really looking at broad-basing their scientific human path. So I think it's important to understand where they are. And looking at tracing these women who are not in professional lives and so are not in the public domain is a huge challenge. Where do these women disappear? How do you trace them, and how do you understand what happened to them after they have acquired the highest degree of training that they are not able to get back to science research? And that was an important question. It is also for me to look at this segment of research to understand how do you learn from those who have survived the systems. Many of us talk of ways in which women don't survive the system. I think I would want to focus on women who survive the system. And I think those stories are also very important that becomes part of the literature. So what is the statistics? I just give you some sense. If you look at 1950 to 51 and you look at women in science, which was very small, 2010-11, the decade growth, it has really grown. And if I look at the disciplines of enrollment of women in the PhDs between 2010 and 18, you will find that science has got a large number. And that is extremely encouraging. It's also important to recognize the encouragement for science research and the support you have, both financial and institutional, is really big in India compared to the other disciplines in India. Not to say that that is sufficient, but I think at the comparative picture, I think the support for science is much larger. If you look at the latest data of 2017-18 and look at the undergraduate, postgraduate, and PhD, I think it gives you a very encouraging picture. Because if you look at the proportions in terms of PhDs, in terms of sciences, it's about 30%, and those are the numbers that you say. I'll just take you to the next slide. Because if you look at the percentage of women in PhDs in the country, overall you have about 30% of them closely who are doing their PhDs, and science has a fairly encouraging number, over 25%, when you're looking at women who have enrolled for PhDs. But the completion rates of PhDs is still not made available. While I said that the AIESH data has tried to put the data for India on a real-time basis, the completion in terms of PhD is something that I think the department has to look at in terms of how many of them are completing. But having said this, it is important to see that you don't find these numbers translating in terms of positions in academic institutions. And that has been the larger question that has sort of defined the research for me. So what does these numbers actually indicate? The numbers indicate that in terms of PhDs, even the latest paper in Wire, they say that we have about 1,61,000 of PhDs being produced in a country on an annual basis. But those numbers are very small. But if you look at the proportion of women, you're happy about it. But I think for a country that is as large as India, these numbers are still small. So the numbers need to rise both for men and women. So one, the growing numbers are indicative of a positive sign in terms of women. Disciplines, there are certain disciplines that have a lower number of women. It is important to ask why. It is also important to present the data of women as a whole. Instead of presenting it as a whole, it's important to present it by domains, because you need to understand which discipline and what disciplines basically attract more women compared to the others. The gender gaps, I think one has to pay attention to. And the changing pattern of the gender gaps is also extremely important, both across levels, among students, faculty, decision makers, leaderships, and institutions, because I think each one of these are a segment that requires special attention. So what is the story of women's low participation in research? One, I think, like what I said to you, that the AIESH data basically gave the gender breakup after 2011. And so now at least you have the data to look at. You have to move beyond the frameworks that have used to understand women in science and claim that it is individual factors and societal factors that are responsible for women not being in science. These frameworks in themselves are very limiting. This is not to underscore that individual choices and societal factors do not play a role, but I don't think they tell you the whole story. It is important to see how workspaces, how policies, and how countries in particular impact women's career path and their participation in science. It is also important to look at the formal spaces, which can be in academia, which could be in industry, And we really do not have studies at the national level that makes a comparison of different academic spaces. Like, what does it mean to be a scientist in a university vis-a-vis an institute of national importance, vis-a-vis an industry, or vis-a-vis in a research lab? Because these are all very different workspaces, and all of them would impact how women actually participate in these places. It is also important to analyze the choices women make critically. Don't look at their choices just at the face value. They have made these choices and they have based it on a certain set of information that they have had. It is important that you understand that. We have to use counter evidence to prove high levels of productivity of women researchers irrespective of marital status. The notion that goes in interview committees, the notion that goes in terms of the perception that women, if they are married, will not perform, has to be challenged. You have to use counter evidence for it. Actually look at publications of women who have actually been married and how their production, in terms of their publications, how it has grown. You need to place it as evidences with policymakers to say that marriage actually need not necessarily impact productivity. Productivity is a very, very individual driven choice that you make. It is also important to make systematic study of publications and the changing pattern across gender. This is one of my pending projects that I want to really look at. When you look at publication patterns, I was talking to a large number of women scientists over this decade, and you find that with respect to publications, men are able to turn the same set of results into n number of publications. Women wait for something that is more comprehensive, and they don't really get into the number game. So how do you evaluate publications beyond actually numbers? I think that will benefit the women scientists much greater than what it is. So how do we get policymakers to really look at this more seriously? Because unless you give them evidences, they are not going to consider what you're trying to tell them. Because a large amount of discussions in policy rooms are based on your individual experiences. That is extremely valid. But I think when you give evidences in terms of numbers, they would take you more seriously. It is also important to unpack the culture of higher education institutions by focusing on practices and processes across gender. How does institutions that have started for several decades, what are the practices that they have? And do they actually make women feel inclusive or less inclusive? These are questions you have to ask, and it's important to acknowledge that women researchers are not a homogeneous group. This is some more data that you have on the Nobel Prize winners. I don't want to spend time. I just want to say that we have smaller numbers. She's the only lone person who's got the Fields Medal. Some of the bright spots are in the Kavli Prize laureates. You have some women faces. You feel good about it, but it's not enough. In the Infosys Prize, we have with us Dr. Sangamitra, so you have women also in some of these award-winning bodies, because I think even the committees also are looking at it with more gender-sensitive lens. Not to say that women are preferred, but I think it's important that there is recognition for women's contribution. So let me just take a few points. It's not all of my research, but I thought I'll just sort of focus on a few points because of lack of time. It's very important for us to understand the structure of opportunity for women researchers. In the survey that we did with the Indian Academy of Science, the notion that women did not do science research because they chose not to do was completely debunked. Women did not do science research because they did not get an opportunity to do science research. And you had more than about 60% of the women who reported this. And so I think this was an important finding. So it's important to see how do you actually create that opportunity. What facilities and what are factors that inhibit their entry into certain lines and not others? Which are the projects through which women actually get in and which are the projects they don't get in? What are the trajectories that they choose? And what influences their choices also is important. There is a real need to make comparative studies on men and women and deeper investigations of the hidden mechanisms that produce discrimination. Because you have to look at how men and women navigate, because there are some of these factors which are very, which are not obvious, but very important and non-obvious. And it's important to see how these factors actually influences and allows one gender to move better than the other gender in terms of their career trajectory. There is also need for historical data that lends to critical and imaginative analysis that is important, and conceptualization of professional identification as career commitment, career satisfaction, and professional self-image is also important. The work-life balance, I think, has a very different trajectory in terms of its understanding. It's important to pay attention, less attention to decision-making processes rather than shift the attention in terms of how women manage conflict. And during a conflict, how do women make choices in terms of addressing the conflict rather than actually looking at conflict as a phenomena? It is important to document and analyze women who negotiate work-life balance that is necessary. Okay, let me go to mentoring and role models, I think, are very important things. And I think when you're looking at role models, women need not look at role models that are extremely high. It's important to have role models that is much closer to where they can achieve. And that is very important. It is also important for women in the science discipline to actually get into more structured mentoring in terms of young professionals, because I think mentoring plays a very key role, which happens very informally with the men. And I think for women, for reasons because of their stretched time and their multiple responsibilities, this has not been given enough attention, and it's important that one looks at it. And more importantly, I want to say that when I say that women are not a homogeneous group, the younger women have also been much different in terms of looking at decisions of their careers. While there were older women who were willing to give up their careers because their husbands get a job in a prestigious institute, today the younger couple want to move to smaller towns so that they also have employment that is equitable in terms of their capabilities. They make decisions of getting married late. They take decisions of not having children. They look at distance marriages as important possibilities. And they also make sure that they have ways in which they are able to have what they define is their choice. And important to see also that they are looking at experimenting with looking at spouses or partners from out of academia. Does that work? Do I have a spouse who doesn't need to travel as much as I travel? So if you look at the women scientists, there are very different ways in which women negotiate their things. So two of them are in academia, they have a pattern in which they do it. You have one in academia and one in the industry, they have a pattern of doing it. The women is in the industry, the man is in the academia, they have a pattern that they emerge. I think all these patterns are neither documented nor analyzed, and it's extremely important that one looks at it. Thank you.